mean us is like the whole spirit community. It's not only me, there are a bunch of people. As you can see on this picture, is what we do is quite easy, is we try to bring people together with sport, with football, because we realize football is something that everybody can at least knows what to do. When the ball is rolling on the floor, it's pretty obvious that you have to kick it. So it's a low key method to bring people together, and it works without language, and it works without explanation. Similar like any other team sport, similar like music, similar like dance, art, theater, everything that is not meant to be explained is good to bring people together. And we are sort of like maniacs, so we love football, we love to travel, we love to meet other people. Like, this is a picture from the desert in Jordan, where we met this guy and that woman, and it's just an insight on what we do. The Verein itself was founded in 2005, and this year, believe it, I cannot believe it, it's 15 years anniversary. It's like 15 years the club or the NGO is existing. Founded by Andrew Harris, a New Zealand guy, came all the way down from New Zealand to Erfurt, and he founded this NGO, and he sets up the climate, the culture. So yeah, this is what we do. We're based in Erfurt, and in German it's called "Wir sind Träger der kommunaler Träger der Kinder- und Jugendarbeit." I don't know what that is in English. It's like the city Erfurt officially approved that our NGO is an organization that is allowed to work with kids and teens. Once you do that, when you're working in that social branch, you have only 1 foot straight in jail, because it's sort of like it's something you have to keep in mind. Even if you have positive approaches, like dealing with working with kids is sort of like it's tricky somehow. So far no one went to jail, so we are still alive, and we celebrate 15 years anniversary, and the thing is, what's that all about? I mean, what are we actually doing? And Ilse told me that you wanted to know how we started and how we grew and what made us successful. And so I would say it's like the two A's. For me, it's two A's. What are the key elements? It's awareness and authenticity. Because if you're working in that field with, it's like a nose business. The thing that we do is nose business. You know, we are not working in marketing or in selling in factories and in industry. We are working with human beings, and you need some of those. Feeling how to deal with other people, and if you haven't, then you are successful. But the thing is, from my experience, it's little amount that you can learn. It's little amount of that you can qualify working with people. Either you have it or you don't have it. So that's why authenticity is nothing that you can learn in a 3 years bachelor. So either you bring it on board, you have it inherent, or not. So if you don't have it, it's hard to, you know, to get this, but it doesn't work if you put a mask on and then you say, I am this guy, you're doing this, and I'm, you know, that doesn't work, you know, it really doesn't work. It's like it's your authentic personality that is the key, working in the field, like working with those youngsters, you know, like they are a bunch of football nerds, and if I would pretend to be the next, what kind of footballer do you know, very important footballer?
Football player?
A football player, you know some? Which one?
Maradona,
actually. If I would pretend that I'm playing like Maradona, which is absolutely not the truth, I'm pretty not so good. Those guys here, they would like, you know, they would immediately feel that, you know, that I'm not skill. So I have to be authentic, and when we're working with those guys, it's cool and it's good to be yourself. That is actually the thing. And awareness is the other A that I would call out, is like what was shown over here, is you have to go out and spread the message. You have to spread the good work that you do. And if you don't raise awareness, then it's a bit complicated. You know, you can do cool things in your little, you know, twiddling out. But if no one gets to see that, it's complicated. It's really complicated. So you heard about Medina. So we had also a Medina. Our Medina is called Andrew Harris. he is that guy that is great for raising awareness. He's the public face, and we have another team, including me, who work sort of more like back office work, and you have to, or we at least, find a good balance. People going to the audience and people doing the groundwork and the back office work, like dealing with taxes, bills, employees, and all that kind of stuff. No one ever wants to do that. So it's a boring piece of crap. No, honestly, this is, and the maintenance and the Verwaltung and all this, like, it's increasing. It got increased over the year. And to sort of like to tell you about the development of Euro football, I brought you this map with those lines. And does anybody know? No, okay. I tell you what, all lines lead to the World Cup. To the World Cup that has been hosted since 2002, because this is what the spirit of football does. Spirit of football takes the ball, like one football, every 4 years to the opening ceremony to the World Cup. And this is this little guy. He's retired right now. You can see he's sleeping and he has no air. This was the ball that we took 2010. To the World Cup in South Africa. Is anybody here who could tell me which line leads to South Africa? I mean, Safar knows it. I wouldn't call out Safar. But do you know which line leads to South Africa?
The right thing.
You mean this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's correct. One applause for you, and you already won a sticker for the right answer. But it all started in 2002 when we took one football all the way down from England. We always started in England with the Germans, and we took one ball to those two countries in 2002. Anybody idea, Safar, of course? Anybody else, any other football maniac in the house who knows the two countries over there?
South Korea and Japan.
Yeah, that is absolutely correct. Two correct answers lead to two. No, I'm not there. Right? 2006, 4 years later, the journey took from England to Germany. That was a pretty short journey because the World Cup was taking place in Germany. In that period of time, the Verein already was established, and then we had this 2010 route through. Let me guess. It was like more than 30 countries that we traveled with this football. It's that one. So that one is this one. That is sort of like a picture from the beginning, and this is how it looks like when you've done like 6 months traveling around the world. And then we have, after 2010, we have even more, 4 years later, we have that pink line taking one ball from London to... In schools it's like this, you have to raise your arm and then the teacher is telling you what is the correct answer. It's not like moving that solution. That restricts the whole episode, but actually you're right. So, okay. You won already.
You have
won.
To quit it.
Yeah, one second. We took one ball from London to Brazil. And people are asking us, why are you doing all of these things? Like you travel, like, and I say, okay, every 4 years we do this amazing journey, and it's like our sort of DNA of the Verein, of the NGO. It's like we travel abroad, we collect stories, we met people, we bring this all together to a curriculum, and this curriculum is called One More, One World, And during those World Cups, we're doing education projects here in Erfurt, in Germany, in whole Europe. And that is why we have to go out to the world to meet people and then tell the story. That is actually the aim. And I want to show you, like, we have a little video. I want to show you a little summary of this journey through 18 countries, and more than 18,000 people gave the signature on one football, and it's only 20 minutes. It's a five minute summary, and if technique works, then enjoy 5 minutes impression of one ball traveling from England to Brazil.
Thank you.
1 million times, and there are always little items that are new to me. So you heard the slogan, it's called One Ball, One World. So like we believe in our work, we have this one football for the journey, it's round, and then you have the world, the globe is also round. And sort of like we don't have another globe, you know, like there is just one and we need to find ways, okay, how can we co-op, how can we all live together peacefully in harmony on this globe without, you know, discriminating each other, letting someone down, putting someone down. And you know, there are a lot of examples what goes wrong right now in the world. So whenever we go to schools in our workshop, whenever we do activities, that's like the theme that we try to promote is one ball, one world. And I want to ask you guys if you can tell me, and not in your language, what one ball, one world. I know that Maria knows some words. It starts with mir, right? Mm-hmm. What is it? In which language is it?
Russian.
Who else can tell me another word and you receive one of those incredible buttons? Isa, what is Latvian?
Vienna Bomba,
Vienna Passau. Oh, wow. Okay, that is something I have to actually write down. So we start here, and Maria, come on, give us some Cyrillic styles. It's not that you're just containing pictures here, it's
I'm part of this.
Okay. Part of this. Passaule. Okay, who else can contribute? Okay. What is it? That's all pretty Spanish. Okay, there are discussions, there are rumors over there. What are you? You receive one sticker for Savan, you know, of course.
It would be Uzbek.
Oh wow, okay, that is interesting. Similar like to Turkish, I think in Turkish it's Bier Top or Bier Dunya. Cool.
What's this Swedish?
Swedish is also, I hope it's, I do it right. In Swedish it would be N. I think that is Swedish, but I'm not 100% sure. Who else can contribute? Which language do you got? Oh wow, okay, go ahead. And immediately by doing that, you know, by putting together all the different languages, you can see how diverse the world is and how diverse we all are. I mean, that's sort of like a natural effect when we go in schools and let kids do this little exercise. Absolutely. Wow! Oh wow! Okay. What is it?
Bengali.
And what do you say?
Eggball
egg
dunia.
Eggball egg dunia. Can you write that in Latin? In the what? you speak it out.
Oh, egg ball, egg dunia. This is one ball, one wall.
Okay. And can you, in brackets, what language?
Battle?
Okay,
go.
And, Benga, okay. Benga, you're crazy. What's your name?
Andreas.
There you go. We just process.
And
you have also another one.
Arabic.
Arabic. Oh, yeah. I was waiting for Arabic. Oh, for Arabic. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But I
think you have the right word. Ura,
Mohada,
Ana. Yeah. So yeah, and talking about diversity, that's a low key exercise to show kids, hey, this is how that's cool. How diverse the world is, right? I mean,
it's a sticker.
It's good that someone pays attention to the moderator. And like here comes the message that has a social or pedagogical impact. There are forces right now in the world, not right now, even like in the long term, they're trying to torn us apart and to divert people, divert communities, and we, our organization, we think no, that's not cool. It's better to stay together, to work together, and let's not other people telling us who is bad or who is good and who has a higher hierarchy or lower hierarchy. That's all bullshit. So we live all on this planet. So as I said, we have to find a way how to come along quite well. And those lines, those colorful lines, also reflect the development of the Verein. There is this light blue line that is the newest one. We went to Russia, to Moscow, to the World Cup in 2018. And pretty much in 2018, the Verein had changed like tremendously. So we came from a grassroots movement, 100% voluntary work. People come to our community space and we had good times to hang out with each other, do a lot of stuff, play football, what football nerds do. But now, then 2018 was a turning point, because we are not only football nerds, we have people on board that have nothing to do with football. They say, I hate football, it's a corrupt game, it's a lot of money involved, FIFA sucks. In the stadium, you get a lot of racism if you are maybe a black guy, for instance. There are so many negative elements on football. I can absolutely understand, and that's why we have more and more people on board, doing workshops in terms of SDG. Right now, we have a strong focus on SDG, like the 17 sustainability development goals from the United Nations. So we work with that. So football is now the sort of like the anchor, but we do more than football. And if you would visit a workshop from Spirit, football maybe is 20%, and the rest is like we talk about geography, we talk about other cultures. It's really really diverse. And so since 2018, we also were able to employ people. So we have now 4 people that are fully employed. So we left the structure of voluntary work, and it has grown quite tremendously. But Martin would say, because I did 6 years ago, I did a workshop or a coaching with Martin, because he helped me out and helped our organization to find our path. Before, it was all a bit like tentacling or meandering, like, oh, this is interesting, let's look over here. There's over there, this plant, a nice plant. It was, we were like on, in the phase of searching or try, error, fail, try again. And then when I had my times with Martin, we were able to sort of like find a way, and that was pretty good, pretty cool, because for myself, I could find a way to combine my talents. Like, I like to travel. I like to meet foreign people. I like to talk about sports and football in particular. And I love to live and work in the environment where I was born, like having my family on board and stuff. I'm a lucky guy, you know, because I have my family here, plus I have the organization and the international people. So for me, that's a jackpot. So that is what Spirit does, and I hope you have many, many, many questions. If not, I have many questions for you. Because I told you that in 2000, like every 4 years we go to the World Cup, right? So the next World Cup, 2022 is in Qatar, right? And can you come up to the map and call out all countries on that journey? Who can do that? Just by the flags and the geographies.
United Kingdom.
United Kingdom? Okay. Similar like a addiction to a drug. So I felt this topic is my stuff. I need to hold it and yeah. And no one, you know, there was only a vision. Like Andrew couldn't offer me anything. It was like, okay, here's a vision. We have this ball journey 2010 to South Africa, and we got this and this and this. And I was like, oh, that's crazy, man. How can you travel around the world with one ball that doesn't work out? You know? It was a vision, and I felt, okay, give it a try. And then after studies, you know, I did other jobs and like similar, like we got heard, you told us like, Isa, you told us like, okay, you have to apply for small fundings, and we went the same way. We were so happy to receive 500 euros for a project week in the school. It was like, yeah, someone is giving us 500 euros for a project week. And then, you know, from 500 we went to 1,000, and then we went to 5,000, and then so on. And it was a growth, a path of growing, till Corona came actually. And then ping, I would do with my profession. So I had other jobs before, they all failed, I failed. I asked myself, what's wrong with you? And so it was destiny, it was bloody destiny. Yeah. I thought actually my plan was to live abroad. I thought like, oh, maybe I go to this country and that country, and maybe I can set up something over there, because I like being abroad. I never planned to live here, work here, and now I have a family, I have a little boy, you know, I'm married, and so that's the story, yeah.
So, are you not German?
Unfortunately, I'm German, yeah.
Because that lady here is in Erfurt. Okay.
I was born and raised in a little city called Weimar.
Oh, okay.
And then, yeah, and the Sweden part is that my, you know, my ancestors, I'm doing right now a research, and it's true, I have Swedish ancestors. They lived in Sweden. Söderberg actually is, in English, is south of a mountain. So they lived somewhere south of a mountain that was the Söderberger clan. And then they came to Germany because of work. Like in 1800, this guy, this old Swedish Söderberg guy, he was a painter. He drew the ceiling of the churches.
Okay.
And then coincidentally, he went on a boat, came to Germany, and then he spread the family, and 200 years later, I'm here. So, so yeah, that's... Yeah?
Maybe you would like to show us a little bit about your experience on how you went about getting some funding for your organization.
As Isa said, it's... okay, here's my message. You need two things to raise successfully fundings. Part one is you need people that can convince others. Like you need someone who's really expressionist and goes to someone like, hey, I have a great idea. We go this and that and we do that. You know, like you need someone who's
charming,
right? You need those people, because welcome to German bureaucracy. You know. There is a lot of money. I mean, no, I don't. You know how it works. There is a lot of money, but it's not laying on the table and you just can grab it. It's like somewhere under here, and you know, like. So that is number one. You have to convince people, and you have to be really like a little dog, you know, like that bites on your.
Yeah.
And second part is you need to be serious in terms of the whole administrative part. So, once you receive money, at the beginning was like this, okay, we receive 500 euros, yeah, cool, okay, but then it was like, oh fuck, how do we get this money actually? You know, like it's not like that someone is throwing the money and you just have to grab it. There is a lot of processes behind all of getting money, and when you talk about bigger money, it's like you have to call for money, then you have to claim your NGO status, you have to prove a lot of papers, and you need to be really, really professional with paperwork. If you're not that type of person who has an heart for professional paperwork, forget it, or employ someone who does that. So, because if you're dealing with public money, it means like they have an eye on it, okay? So it's It's not your money, it's public money. So, and you have to be really ordentlich Deutsch. So, take on the deadlines, write, fill out the right formulas. No, don't do this mouse, you know, like you have a mistake and you take this mouse thing and don't do that, you know. Take a new formula and be precise and be ordentlich and because proving the money that you have to prove what you've done with your money, that is a major fact. And once you screw up with that, you know, that sticks in people's head, like, the spirit of football, guerrilla people, those guys, yeah, once we gave them money, but we don't know what they did with that money, because we never heard about it. You know, like, so, it's this social entrepreneurship, I think, you have to realize that we are not selling an item. I'm not producing a bottle of water, and I give it to you, and you give me 10 euros, and end of story. What we do is we sell, that's why I brought this, we sell emotions, and we sell stories. Emotions you can't grab, you know, you can't grab, you can't just, it's virtual. And that's why it's so complicated to, on the open market, it's complicated to sell that product. That's why we're dealing with a lot of funds. And so, two things. This guy who is convincing people and be precise with the operation. That's my experience. And it doesn't go from 0 to 100%, it goes more like little steps. Like, this is actually our experience. Like, you need a long, in Germany we say, you need a long breath. You have to inhale, and then it's not like, you know, it's not like from 2010 to 2011 we were able to employ 4 people. No way, it doesn't work. It just simply doesn't work. So you need to be really, you need good stamina, you need good condition. And we all, like the people that you saw, we all had like different jobs, and we were, you know, working normal jobs. If that, I don't know what a normal job is, but you know.
They're saying we had it, so now this is your normal job. What?
This is, since 2017, I'm fully employed, I don't do anything else. But before 2017, it was like, okay, working over here, was a freelancer over there, trying to make money to survive, to pay the rent, and you know, and yeah. But since 17, actually, we also get funded by the Nord-Süd-Brücken Stiftung, and so we found the foundation that, yeah, this is, once you dive into this field of, you know, then you swim, then you dive, and then you. Who's there? Okay, those guys, you know, I think you have to start, and then you have to be really convinced by your own that you follow a vision, and that you said, okay, and don't do it alone. That is my advice, don't do it alone, because A, it's more fun to do things together, and B, there are talents out there that help you, because I'm really bad at other stuff, but I know I have a team of people, they can help me out. As now, they know that I can help them out as well. So, that's our story. I wouldn't say that applies for all of the stories. At least it's our story.
And now there are people.
And
now hire people for your work.
We have to, actually. Yeah, we have to hire people, yeah. And we do hire people, and but not in, as a, not like tomorrow, I'm not hiring people tomorrow, but maybe next year if we have a big project for 3 years, if that comes through, we can employ 3 people. If it doesn't come through, okay, then, yeah. So we are an employee, as we are employee, as a we are employers, but don't think in ranges like, okay, hundreds of 50. We're talking about 4 people, and a lot of freelancers and volunteers. Yeah, and that's the thing. It all starts with freelancing, because, like Lottomittel, for instance, if you apply for Lottomittel and they give you 6,000 euros, you're not allowed to use that money to employ someone. So the restrictions are linked to the money, right? So we have to be creative in how to use that money. So if I cannot employ someone, can I like hire someone like to be a freelancer? It's it's also dedicated. But if you're creative and think around the corner, as they used to say in Germany, in the academy, then it, can go quite well. Well, Isa, is that right what I'm saying?
Yeah, it is. You're the best example.
Yeah, it's always restrictions. It's restrictions, restrictions. And you know, like even me as a natural born, not killer, but German, you know, you read out those policies and those, and it's like, oh, what kind of language is that? You know, it's a weird language. That for you guys that are not mother tongue speaking German, that is a huge challenge. So go and get someone who is translating that stuff for you. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Honestly, even I struggle. I struggle with this paragraph 1, 24 Absatz 3, Gebühr. That's crazy sometimes.
Yeah, but it's also protection, because if someone says there's corruption and you didn't use the money the way you should have to, if you fulfill all things, if you did the paperwork right, you're on the right side, then you're safe.